Have you ever set an impossible goal for yourself and ended up way over your head?
Who's coming with me? Who's coming with me?
Well, that's how we felt with the Dygma Defy at some point. We had a goal, a mission. We wanted it to be wired. We wanted it to be Bluetooth. And we also wanted it to work with low latency RF. To top it all off, we didn't want to give up any of the ergonomic features like the split design, integrated tenting, 16 thumb keys, reverse tilting, you name it. It was like trying to fit four elephants in a Mini Cooper. How did we achieve it? Well, two in the front and two in the rear, obviously. Hi Digmates, I'm Dominique, and today we're gonna dive deep into how we managed to do what other keyboard manufacturers haven't even attempted. But first, let's start with the basics. How do keyboards work? When you press a key on a conventional wired keyboard, the circuit under the switch closes. Then a microchip reads that signal, translates it into a key code, and sends it to your computer, which displays the character on the screen. We call that chip a key scanner. Wireless keyboards work similarly, only that instead of sending the key codes through the cables, it sends them via Bluetooth or RF. On RF, that information is sent to a tiny receiver connected to your computer. On Bluetooth, it's received directly by the computer. So far, pretty straightforward. But what about split keyboards? Well, here's where things get interesting. Being split, these keyboards have two key scanner microcontrollers on each side. Then there's a third chip that acts as a main microcontroller for the keyboard. It's responsible for receiving the key presses from both sides and sending the information to the computer. Some keyboards have their main microcontroller inside one of the halves, like the Moonlander or the Keyboardio Model 100. Others have it as a separate component, like the Dygma Race. Why? Well, this lets you use either half of the keyboard, not only the one with the main microcontroller. There are also some wireless split keyboards like the Kinesis Advantage 360 Professional and the Glove 80. In these keyboards, the key scanner on the right side communicates via Bluetooth to the main microcontroller on the left side. Then the main microcontroller sends the correspondent key code to the computer via Bluetooth or USB. Neither of these keyboards has low latency RF or can be used fully wired. The right side will always connect via Bluetooth to the left side. So if we wanted to make a split programmable keyboard with all three modes, Bluetooth, RF, and wired, how the frick were we gonna do it? Conception.
Hey, I got it! I found the solution! What if we connect both sides of the keyboard with a cable and then one side connects to the computer via RF or Bluetooth?
But that defeats the purpose of having a wireless keyboard, idiot! What if we had one main microcontroller on each side and it connects to the computer via RF, Bluetooth, or wired?
That would solve the cable issue. But that could be like having two separate keyboards connected to the computer.
It already sounds like a nightmare to use and configure. We need a super neuron, a microcontroller capable of handling communications in all three modes and switching between them without any interruptions. In wire mode, both sides connect with the neuron and the neuron with the computer, just like in the race. In RF mode, the neuron is plugged into the computer and both sides connect to the neuron via RF. In Bluetooth mode, it gets more complicated. The neuron is plugged under the left side of the keyboard. Then the right side connects to the left side via RF. And finally, the neuron connects to the computer via Bluetooth.
Not so fast. That's easier said than done.
Chips, chips everywhere!
For our concept to work, we designed a keyboard that comprised five microchips. To start, we have a key scanner microcontroller on each half of the keyboard and a main microcontroller in the neuron. That's how the standard wired mode works. Then there are two RF gateway microcontrollers, one on each side, allowing wireless communications between both sides and the neuron. Additionally, the batteries on each side need an integrated circuit to drive it properly. Also, we need another integrated circuit to drive the LEDs. Selecting the chips wasn't solely based on meeting technical requirements, but rather on finding reliable and cost-effective options that wouldn't be affected by the current global chip shortage. Fortunately, we could apply our past experiences with microchip providers and successfully secured what we needed. After a lot of research and deliberation, we finally settled on the RP2040 chip for the key scanners, the Nordic NRF52820 for the RF gateways, and the Nordic NRF52833 for the Neuron. We talked about this in detail in another video, so make sure you watch it. With the chips sorted, it was time to tackle the next big challenge.
The complexity of the PCB design.
From an electronic standpoint, the main issue we had to face was the size of the PCB of the Super Neuron. We wanted it to be beautiful, light, and small enough to fit inside your pocket. So it was really tough to fit all the logic inside this little thing. Just the three USB-C connectors alone already take up a lot of space. So we designed the PCB of the Neuron to have four layers. Imagine you had to load a dishwasher with all dishes, pans, and glasses of all shapes and sizes. Finding the space to fit everything can be complicated, but I'm sure you've sorted it out more than once. Now imagine all those dishes are connected with wires, and that all those wires have to have a clear path and not get tangled. Not easy, right?
We have put a lot of effort to ensure that everything was connected properly and nothing interfered with anything, and we finally done it.
And that takes us to the next challenge, programming the firmware. Hey, what happened to the mice?
Oh, they had a break.
Huh. Anyway, remember the five chips? Well, we had to program each chip, from the key scanners to the RF gateway chips, to behave in a specific way. And we had to do it for each mode, wired, RF, and Bluetooth. If that wasn't enough, we had to ensure that switching from one mode to another would work seamlessly without compromising the user experience. It was like teaching a classroom full of rowdy students to just shut up and do their seat work.
Shut up!
We already had some legwork done since we had the Dygma arrays as our basis. For example, we knew the LED driver was relatively straightforward since we used the same one for the arrays. The complicated part was in Kaleidoscope, the firmware library that supports the arrays, which we also used for the Defy. However, this library was created for wired communications only, not wireless. So, how did we make it work? Well, originally, the Neuron was the master of the communications. It would ask the key scanners 600 to 1,000 times per second if a key press was registered. And the key scanner on each side would report back to the Neuron.
Yippee!
This works excellently for wired, but it's an inefficient solution for wireless because it would draw too much power from the battery and the keyboard wouldn't be as responsive. So we had to rewrite most of the library and make the key scanner the master of communications. Instead of the Neuron asking for new keystrokes, we made the key scanner automatically tell the Neuron when there was one.
Gimme.
But even the boss needs to know the rules, and that's where protocols come in. Protocols are essential for devices to communicate effectively. They act as a sort of grammar, providing rules for message transmission, error correction, and formatting. To ensure a stable wireless connection, we needed to utilize protocols that allow for seamless data transfer and have no data loss capabilities. We had the SPI protocol to enable wireless communications from one chip to another, the link protocol for RF or radio frequency, and human interface device protocol to send data from the neuron to the computer. But that's not all. With all this communication and systems going inside the keyboard, we still had to ensure our baby passed the final test, the certification. All those communications created a lot of electromagnetic noise.
Loud noises!
And every time we added or modified a component, it increased emissions. Therefore, whenever we made a change, we had to certify it again and again and again. To ensure everything was within parameters, we had to adjust the firmware and, more importantly, enhance the cable's shielding. After a bit, I mean a lot of back and forth, they all finally passed. I can go on and on about the horror story of the certification, but maybe it's just better you check out the video we made. So there you have it, making a split programmable keyboard with all three modes of connectivity, Bluetooth, RF, and wired, is no easy feat. But we did it, and we're damn proud of it. Next up, manufacture thousands of units of this. Who wants to talk about this next? Because I'm done. This was way too much. Mick? Manel? Louise? But that defeats the purpose of it being wireless! Gago! Buang!
What does that mean?
Linte ang imo ilong galaba! I just told you your nose is getting longer. Na! Mirise! Una na nagkalbo ka!